You're watching Reality Check. We're in Mumbai, where the city's hospitals are overwhelmed. Not just the COVID wards, but even COVID ICUs. Every single bed is full to capacity. Now, it's in these ICUs where critical life and death battles against the virus are being fought every single day. And it's in these ICUs where healthcare professionals face the greatest risk. That's why my colleague Maryam Alvi, camera person Xavier Thomas and I came to this private hospital where we were allowed to film inside the COVID ICU.
The Nanavati Hospital in Santa Cruz. They have 110 COVID beds, 20 of them in their COVID ICUs. The largest of any private player in Mumbai. But like all the other hospitals in Mumbai, they're full to capacity. Needless to say, we followed all safety protocols, not just for our own safety, but for those, all of those who were involved. The identities of patients concealed.
Now, this is not to say that this is an endorsement of Nanavati Hospital or of private healthcare. Private players have been criticized for not holding up their end during the pandemic. The front line is still public health and public hospitals. But our idea was to give you a behind-the-scenes look of the kind of risks and crucial decisions that healthcare professionals are facing and taking every single day. It's to show you how the virus can turn deadly even for the very young, but also to show you how the battle against the virus is being fought and won.
We are outside the CCU unit at the Nanavati Hospital and we will be entering this soon, doctor. But before we do that, we just want to make sure it's all okay. How safe is it for us to enter? How safe is it for the patients for us to be there?
So, Varun, we are all in a war zone. This is exactly where the actual war zone is. No doubt, we have to go inside only with a very clear understanding that you need to stay away from all the patients and maintain a real distance. Number two, you have to wear complete PPE. You cannot go like this in any other streetwear for your own safety. As far as the patient safeties are concerned, I think you are going to stay away from most of the patient critical areas. You are not going to obstruct any of the healthcare worker doing their work, which obviously you won't. You can definitely speak to our healthcare workers to understand what they are doing, but obviously from a distance, because we don't want you to be coming in close proximity, and you have to follow the strict donning and doffing criteria of PPE. We are going to give you a complete visual presentation, how exactly a donning should be done. One of our infection control nurse will be also there to help you out. The complete set has to be done and worn properly. And while coming out, we'll ensure that you doff out properly, come out in the scrubs that we will be providing you, change, wash out, and then only you can go into the public. So with that, it is reasonably safe, and I can say with reasonable confidence, you won't be a threat to our patients, but we are worried that you should not come out with any of the possible infection and take it to the community.
But as long as we wear the protective gear, the PPE, and we dispose of it properly, we shouldn't be a threat to others either.
I don't think so, and we will ensure that you are not.
Okay, thank you so much, doctor.
Thank you.
This is how it all starts. You first change into scrubs and then you get into a safety kit. So we are now going to get our own personal experience of what doctors who work in these COVID ICUs go through every time they go into work.
Very nice. Beard should be prominent.
So this is the after. You saw the before. This is the after of what every doctor has to go through to end up like this. And we've been, Maryam and I have been in this for I think barely 10 to 15 minutes. And we're already just sweating, bathed with sweat from inside.
Thank you.
Okay, so we're all set to go into the critical care unit at Nanavati Hospital. And with us is Dr. Ansari. He's the chief intensivist here. But he's not in PP wear. He's standing outside because he's the general. And he's been told to not go into the trenches. Is that the idea?
So you're right. We are the people behind the lines, behind the fight, the enemy lines, you can say. But we are.
You're itching to go though.
Yeah, we are raring to go and itching to go inside. But, you know, we need to be here to take care of the men inside.
Right.
Because they need to be, in strict rotation.
Right.
They need to be quarantined.
Right.
At the same time, there have to be strict working hours.
Right.
They cannot expose themselves for a long time because of the viral loads.
And
okay.
How many patients are we going to see inside?
20. We are all full. We have 20 beds over here in COVID ICU.
All
of them are occupied. That's right.
Okay.
In fact, we have two in the emergency bay right now waiting to come.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's
thanks.
Our new journey. Yeah. Please.
Thank
we'll
you.
See you on the other side.
Thank you.
Hi. Hi, everybody.
Uncle. Kaise hai?
Very good.
Okay, now we're actually inside the critical care unit of Nanavati Hospital, and we have with us Dr. Manish. You can see that he's Dr. Manish because it's written there with a nice smiley face. That's how everyone identifies. And we also have with us Dr. Chirag with us. And so Dr. Manish, tell us now exactly what are we looking at here? What are we looking at on both sides?
So that is a CCU1 and this is CCU2.
Okay.
CCU1 is only for positive patients. Only corona positive patients can be admitted there.
Okay.
So once you cross that red line, you are a positive patient and hence you can cross it.
Okay.
Here we have positive patients as well as we have suspected patients because we have cubicle systems here. So we can still maintain that isolation between a suspect and a COVID positive.
Okay.
Suspect also very high suspicion of COVID, then only we take them here.
Okay.
Otherwise, we keep them in the red A&E. We keep them there if they are not very highly suspected of COVID. So because we don't want to mix all the patients. This is our CCU1. We have 10 beds and we have 10 patients here. You can see all different kind of patients. We have an intubated patient who is requiring quite significant high oxygen support. Then we have some patients who are young patients who are on non-rebreather mask.
Okay.
That is the highest way of giving oxygen without putting a patient on the ventilator.
Okay.
So any patient you see with those masks are just on the brink. If they worsen further, they might go onto the ventilator.
Okay.
So we take care of all kind of patients here.
Almost straight away, we see young men inside the ICU. Let's just talk a little bit about him. So what exactly is happening with him? What's the story there?
He's got infected with the coronavirus and then it is causing him to become more and more breathless. It is the oxygen requirement keeps on increasing. You cannot
even though he's a young guy.
So there are some young patients who are going very sick. We still don't understand why they are going sick because they don't have premorbid conditions. But they have this cytokine kind of a storm inside the body, which
right.
causes a damage inside. The virus activates your own immune system and then your own immune gets into a hyperactivity.
Okay.
That causes a problem and that causes the breathlessness.
Right next to him, another man, 39 years old, but far more critical. Who would you say is perhaps the most critically ill patient in here who you're really worried about?
On this side, the most critical patient is this. On bed number 10.
What are the concerns there?
The concerns are that his blood pressure is not maintained, his oxygenation is not maintained, he is not able to pass good amount of urine.
Mm.
So his three major organs are affected if you talk like lungs, the heart and the kidney. These are the three major tripod on which life stands basically.
Okay.
So those three organs are affected all because of the coronavirus and we are trying to support it.
You're giving him intensive care to support that?
Yes, intensive care to support it.
Now tell me something, because all of you here are very, very heavily protected, and rightly so. But there is still an element of risk.
Yes, definitely, yes.
When does that happen? When does the greatest risk happen in the treatment of a patient?
The greatest risk happens when you are intubating a patient. It's a procedure called intubation. When you put on the ventilator, when you put the tube which is going through that gentleman's mouth, when you put that tube,
right.
you are directly exposed to the lungs, the whole blast comes. And for that, we are using protective gears, we are using the shield, we have the eyewear, we have the whole mask, and we also have an intubation box.
Right.
We use that box to reduce that aerosol generation and to reduce that exposure to the doctors who are doing it.
But there is still always that 1%.
Yes, definitely. The nurses that we call, the doctors, everybody doing procedure, everybody handling their bodily fluids, cleaning them and stuff. So there is always a risk of getting infected. Even though you are wearing a PPE, still people are getting infected.
In the second ICU, the most critical patient is a doctor.
So he's one of the sickest patients that we have currently. Mm. And as you can see, he's on a lot of support. He's on ventilator support to maintain his oxygenation and ventilation. He's on inotropic supports to maintain his blood pressure, because his blood pressure he's not able to maintain by himself. His blood pressure drops to about 60/40, non-sustainable with life. Hence, we have to keep medications on so that the blood pressure is maintained and we can buy time for him to recover.
How old is he?
He is 69 years old.
Okay. And he already had any earlier?
Yeah, he's hypertensive, he's diabetic, and he's a doctor himself as well.
Oh, he's a doctor himself. Okay. We wish him well.
And you also have a doctor
you're
treating. Now, this in some ways, does it make it somewhat personal? When you
So let me tell you that. I have been treating sick individuals for a very long time now. But this is the first time where doctors are themselves worried of catching the infection and giving it to their colleagues and their family members. And which scares you the most? And when you look at somebody like 35, 40 who is sick, you can actually relate to that. That it could be actually any one of us at that point of time. And that really scares, and that's probably the human angle. But apart from that, I think
in this
once,
particular doctor's case,
he was
not disclosing his identity.
Yeah.
We believe a reputed neurologist.
Yeah.
So
he's not into active clinical practice also. So it looks like he has got it from the community rather than from his patients in patient interaction, but difficult to say.
Doctors here are doing everything to save one of their own, including plasma therapy.
But in this case, in the case of this gentleman, is the plasma helping?
So it's very difficult because it got complicated with a concurrent myocardial infarction.
Right.
So myocardial infarction in COVID disease is
which
a known entity.
Heart attack.
Yeah. So it's like this disease triggered a heart attack for this gentleman and pushed him into a cardiogenic shock, which is one of the mechanisms of clinical deterioration in a lot of COVID patients.
So you would still say that it's too early to say that plasma therapy can be a game changer.
Yeah, I think
it's still the jury is still out.
So yes, I would say it's still at best an adjuvant therapy, not the primary form of therapy for COVID. Added on with other supportive therapy, critical care, it can definitely have an important role to play, but timing would be important.
We've been doing critical care for some time.
Yes, about 9 years now.
9 years, but this is different, right?
This is very different. It is taxing on a lot of levels. Firstly, when I leave for work, I know there is a risk involved,
right.
A huge risk involved. And it's not just me. On the back of my mind, I have my parents also.
Yes.
They are ailing, they are getting old, I am the only son. So there are a lot of things riding on it when I come here.
So it's like you're not just worried about your patients, but
also about
the first
myself,
time you're
also
worried
about my parents. Yes, I am worried about everybody around me. And that is the reason why I have not been able to go home. It's been more than 2 months, I have not seen my parents.
Everything okay with him?
Yeah, he's okay. He's just irritated a little with the mask and everything.
Okay.
His oxygen saturation is low, but still he's happy with that saturation, and he's not feeling breathless. So the mask irritates him.
He was complaining about the mask being uncomfortable. Yeah, is that a regular complaint that patients have?
So claustrophobia is one of the biggest things that can happen when you put them on non-invasive ventilator, the NIV.
But this claustrophobia among patients is... discomfort.
Elderly people, little disoriented people, they are the ones who are more claustrophobic, but sometimes even young people can complain.
So doctor, one thing I think Mariam was asking you is a good point, that just wearing these kits, it's anonymous, right? You don't know, I mean,
who you're talking to.
Who do you know who you're talking to? Your own colleagues you can't recognize.
Yes, it's difficult to recognize. So we have these names and written on the badge.
So that's the only way that you know that that's Dr.
Yes, Dr. Prachi.
Prachi. And so everyone just because of these names
we can know. And in fact, it becomes difficult for the awake patients as well, because they can't see their doctor. It's a relationship between the patient and the doctor, which develops when you have name to it, you have a face to it. They don't recognize me by my face. They just recognize me by my voice and by my name.
There's a lot of fear amongst the patients. They are also in a tense situation. They can't see your faces. All they're seeing is a mask.
Yes. And
how do you deal with that?
We try to calm them down. They are all scared, and everybody is scared, because if I was a patient and I would see somebody coming like this to see me, I would be damn scared that what's wrong with me.
And it must be difficult for the doctors as well. You don't get to meet your colleagues. Nobody.
Nobody. It's like a glorified jail. We hardly meet anybody. I can't even meet my boss. I can't meet my parents. I can't go home. I can't meet my colleagues. Nothing. कैसे हैं अंकल? अंकल कैसे हैं? जैसा ऑक्सीजन नेजल पंप से 2 लीटर लगा के देखो, फिर बताओ मैंने कितना था।
So you have this patient who gets admitted for accident.
Yeah.
He's got multiple fractures.
Correct. Rib fracture, clavicle fracture, lung contusion, breathing difficulty.
Right. Now he shows symptoms of COVID.
Yeah.
So you test him with a normal swab.
So
he comes out negative.
Correct.
But you still suspect that he may have it.
Yes.
And then you put him through a CT scan.
Yeah. So the whole thing is, we do a CT scan, and we have learned over a period of time, and there is international enough literature which is piling in, that there is a very particular pattern of viral pneumonia which is very specific towards COVID infection.
I see, and which a CT scan can pick up.
Can pick up. So there is a scoring called CORAD score, which can grade from 0 to 6, where exactly do you stand. And 4, 5, 6 scores very highly likelihood of having a viral pneumonia.
I see. So even though this gentleman may have tested negative on
correct.
The swab,
correct.
He's got a high score on the CT scan,
and you would actually suspect,
indicating that he is likely,
very likely, and you may repeat a swab again if the clinical profile is still suggestive of COVID like illness.
Wearing this PPE, it's not comfortable. It's taxing. It also affects you mentally, because you don't have that freedom, and you feel claustrophobic with the mask all the time, with the shield. Your vision is not well. I am looking through the eyewear plus the shield while doing procedures. I find difficulty doing procedures.
In fact, your mask is already fogging up. So
yes.
And in this entire time, you can't go to the loo.
No.
Till you have a break, you have to be in this.
Yes.
And you get your first break, I think I was told, every 6 hours.
Yes. A break for meal as well as to go to the washroom and do everything.
Till then, you're fully strapped in.
We are fully strapped in. We are fully working here all the time.
How about you, Doc? Mentally, how's it been?
Yeah, but currently it's not possible to wear this PPE.
Mm.
It's very difficult to wear. It's like camel.
Like a camel?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's where you have to reserve the water. Now we can see the nurses and those inside the ward moving around. Give us a sense of what exactly are they going to be doing.
So they take their morning rounds. They monitor the urine output. They monitor the blood pressure, the oxygen saturation.
Mm-hmm.
They make sure that all the treatment is going on time and everything. They make sure that the charting is done.
Sister, थोड़ा सा बताइए कि how is the, what is the experience? Because you must have had the experience of working in ICU पहले भी.
Yeah. But पहले
what is the ऐसा कभी experience रहा है आपका?
नहीं, पहले तो कभी भी नहीं.
क्या इस बार सबसे बड़ा चेंज क्या है इस बार?
सबसे बड़ा चेंज तो ये किट है जो किट डाल के हर एक पेशेंट को देखना पड़ता है. एंड
ऑलरेडी आपको गर्मी हो रही है इसमें.
हाँ, होती है गर्मी. एंड हर एक पेशेंट को उतना ही केयर देना पड़ता है जैसे कि पहले भी देते थे विदाउट किट देते थे, तो वैसे ही केयर देना पड़ता है उनको. मेन मोटो वही होता है कि उनको हर एक मेडिसिन जो है प्रॉपरली टाइम टू टाइम चाहे, हर एक नर्सिंग के प्रॉपरली टाइम टू टाइम चाहे.
डॉक्टर प्राची, व्हाट डू यू डू हियर?
She's the other one, resident
medical. She's resident, okay. So you're the young one. Difficult? How have you been finding it?
Learning a lot.
Learning a lot?
Like just today, he was teaching me in the morning, like small things, even talking to patients, counseling them for many things, like because they can't really interact, and then there are no, like senior doctors can't really visit as much as normal times.
There are patients on the brink, but then there are those like this woman who offers hope.
She has recovered. She did not worsen to the extent that she went on to the ventilator.
Okay.
So she improved and she is slowly being tapered off the oxygen requirement.
Oh, that's wonderful. Recovering. Yeah, she's sitting up.
Yes.
She seems to be doing much better.
She's doing much better. And she should be shifted out to the wards in a day or so. And then from there in a day or two, she will be discharged home and she would be...
Oh, that's wonderful. How old is she? How old is she?
I guess she is 76.
65
years old.
She
had hypertension and diabetes as well.
She may have defeated the virus, but we later learn she may have more personal battles on her hands.
To top it all, unfortunately, the family was not very supportive. They were in quarantine and actually a point came where they stopped taking our calls. And
the family stopped taking...
So they were not reachable actually, and finally a point came where we decided that we continue doing everything till we can move her out or she could be safe enough to be discharged.
Are you saying that in a sense she was almost abandoned by the family?
Well, I would say close to that, but it's yet to be seen whether they will finally come for the discharge. I hope they will.
His shift over, Dr. Manish gets ready to leave.
So this is actually a very important part of the whole idea of being in an ICU and of taking care. So what we saw was donning, where we put on safety wear. This is called doffing, where you take it out. And as with putting it on, you have a series of very specific, elaborate procedures you have to follow. But in this case, Mariam, it's, as we were given a demonstration, it's even more critical than putting on clothes. When you're taking it off is when you're facing the greatest risk of infection.
Yes, Vasu, because you're... PPE kits have been exposed to the virus in the ward. When we were wearing it outside, we were wearing fresh kits, clean, sanitized, sterile. These are infected, so which is why he's making sure that the infected side is inside. He's making sure that it is disposed properly and he's not touching anywhere with that infected kit.
Right. So he's obviously a seasoned pro, so he's done it in like super fast time. But otherwise, it's a pretty slow procedure for those who are doing it for the first time. So we are now done here. I think the idea is not to spend too much time either, but it just gave us in a very concentrated way a very intense sense of what it's like to work in literally the front lines of this battle.
Yes, Vasu, like we've been here what for less than an hour or so and our glasses are fogged up, we're sweating inside.
Yeah.
It's not the easiest thing, we can't hear each other too well, we have to speak louder.
Yeah. So the lucky thing is we are getting out in just about 20-25 minutes, but everyone here, this entire group, for them, their shift has just begun. I'm trying to find the knot.
After an 8-hour shift in the ICU,
These are the exhausted faces of nurses, the grooves from protective wear etched into their skin. So we are here on the lovely balcony of Nanavati Hospital. You won't actually know you're in a hospital if you're standing in this balcony, least of all a hospital in Bombay, with Dr. Ansari, who's the chief intensivist. Now, Dr. Ansari, we went in, we saw the ICU. Obviously, it's a very modern ICU. And we do have to point out that this is a privilege though, isn't it? Because this is a private hospital and the kind of care that you see here, you're not likely to see that in a government hospital. Does that make a difference with a virus like COVID, that the patients who we saw right now in some ways have better odds of surviving than they were in a government hospital?
So, Vasu, this is probably a question which is difficult on both the public and private sector. What is very important is that a disease like COVID will need a very resource-intensive setting to really make a difference in those people who probably could not have been salvaged, but with a lot of effort, you may probably save them.
So that does make a difference. The kind of medical care you receive can make the difference between life and death. It's not that you're a gone case just because you have it.
No. So especially we have a few survivors who have been really having multiple comorbidities, who did well, possibly because we were able to identify them early. We were able to provide them a much more, one-to-one nursing, a close monitoring. And even if they needed organ supports, they were transient and we could monitor and wean them off very early.
Right.
I won't say that this cannot happen because very sick individuals, even in this setting, may not survive.
You've had deaths.
Yes, so we have deaths.
How many people have died?
Deaths so far. We have nearly treated more than 350 COVID patients altogether. And of them, nearly 60 were critically ill. And of them, we have got nearly 12 deaths, which actually, if you look at, is seemingly high. But the kind of gravity of patient that we had, a lot of, at least 14 people were on ventilator. Of them, we had at least 6 or 7 who have survived ventilation. And a few are already on ventilator. So if you look at that, a lot of things are going on. But majority of the patients who got better possibly could have not been salvaged in a setting where you could not monitor them closely. You cannot provide them superior care with, you know, prone ventilation, which is difficult.
Right. So it does make a difference if you can provide high quality care.
Correct.
But as we know, high quality care comes at a cost.
Right.
And it's frankly expensive to be in hospitals like this. And this may not be a fair question to ask you because you're a doctor, but there have been questions about overbilling and of people being overcharged, even here at Nanavati, for that kind of care.
So, Vasu,
in the middle of a pandemic. Ordinarily you'd say yes, but even in a pandemic.
There are two aspects to it, Vasu. This is very clear that every life counts. Every life matters.
Yes.
So those people who can afford and those who want to have that that approach of aggressive therapy, they would definitely will have to pay for the higher comorbidity with higher interventions per day, higher need for antibiotic and investigations.
Right.
And that will definitely add on to the cost.
Last question to you. I mean, this has to be the toughest. You know, you've been in ICU for intensive care for a long time. Has this been the hardest to...
Yeah, so because this is a battle where previously we have seen much more sick individuals. We have seen bomb blast victims.
Yes.
We have seen previously leptospira. We have seen dengue.
Yes.
And there were major onslaughts in the city of Mumbai.
Yes.
And it has always fought back, resilient as it is. But this time, the fear is of contracting illness.
Yourself.
Giving it to your other, you know, colleagues or your loved ones. And that's where you are actually in isolation.
And that's happened here. Almost 50 people have been infected.
Staff and their family members in
Sab
general. But 5 or 6 from the intensive care unit and the critical care areas, they also got infected. So that scares you. At the same time, you know, makes you kind of go back and keep on asking you, what are we doing wrong?
That's an interesting point, that of those who got infected, a smaller number were from...
Oh, yes.
Those who are working in the wards.
So that's a
paradox. And a bigger number were those outside. So of the 50, only 5.
So Vasu, you wore the armory.
Infected in the ward. Yeah.
Yeah. So when you are going into the most infected zone, you actually take extra precaution. Every step you are, you know, kind of very, very cautious. While in a lesser sick environment, or probably in the non-COVID areas, or in the community, you are actually thinking by just wearing a mask, you are absolutely...
So
you
know, bulk invincible. Of your healthcare workers who got infected
yeah.
were infected not in...
Not actually ward. In the hospital, a few but of them the, from the community,
in the community,
a few in the non-COVID areas like CT scan or a radiology area or the security guys. We have seen that even our policemen have been found positive just by virtue of being in you know, exposure of people traveling.
Right. So we have with us a sister who actually
tested
positive. What's your name, sister?
My name is Yugandhara Kelustar. Yugandhara Kelustar.
Okay. And you were working in the COVID ward? And you tested positive? How many days ago?
10 days of hospital admit.
Sure. अभी ठीक हैं आप?
अभी ठीक
और दोबारा आप कोविड वार्ड में ड्यूटी चल रहे हैं?
हाँ, क्योंकि सब मैडम लोगों ने, डॉक्टर लोगों ने मुझे एनकरेज किया कि कोविड वार्ड में करने के लिए कि कुछ नहीं होता. मैं पहले डर गई थी, बहुत डर गई थी कि कोविड वार्ड में काम करना है, लेकिन उसके बाद मुझे पॉजिटिव टेस्ट आया और 10 दिन के बाद मैं ठीक हो गई. तो मुझे करना है क्योंकि मेरा ये नर्सिंग पेशा है, तो मुझे
ये करना ही है.
करना ही है.
लेकिन आपको हुआ कैसे, आपको पता चला?
मुझे पहले कफ था.
अच्छा.
और
नहीं, कॉफ ठीक था, लेकिन किस तरह से आपको आपने पकड़ा?
मतलब मैं पहले कोविड वार्ड में थी, मेरे साथ जो रूममेट थी तो उनको पहले पॉजिटिव आई, उनके साथ में थे इसलिए मुझे टेस्ट किया.
अच्छा, आपका रूममेट की वजह से?
हाँ.
और रूममेट को कैसा कोविड हुआ, कुछ पता चल पाया?
वो भी कोविड वार्ड में थी लेकिन उसको फीवर आया, तो फीवर आया तो उसको एडमिट किया.
नहीं, बट उसने क्या क्या किसी को, जैसे वो इंक्यूबेट कर रही थी क्या, उसको इन्फेक्शन कैसे पकड़ा, वो कुछ पता चल पाया?
तो वो पता नहीं, लेकिन वो मेरे साथ ही थी.
लेकिन सर, आप लोग सब पूरा पीपी वगैरह सब पहने हुए थे?
सब पहने हुए थे.
उसके बावजूद भी उसको, आपके रूममेट को हो गया, फिर आपको हो गया?
आप कह रहे थे कि आपके फैमिली भी यहाँ मुंबई में नहीं रहते, दूर रहते हैं.
मेरा कोंकण में रहते हैं.
कोंकण में रहते हैं?
हाँ.
अच्छा.
वो मैं इधर हॉस्टल में रहती
हूँ. उनको तो बहुत डर लगा होगा जब...
हाँ, वो तो पहले ही बोल रहे थे कि छोड़ कर आ जा, लेकिन अभी नर्सिंग चूज किया तो करना ही पड़ता था, इसलिए मैं नहीं.
पहले ही बोल रहे थे छोड़ के आ जाओ, फिर पॉजिटिव भी आया तो
वो बहुत डर गए थे, इसलिए.
लेकिन अब ठीक है?
अब ठीक है.
चलिए सिस्टर, थैंक यू सो मच, ऑल द वेरी बेस्ट सिस्टर, थैंक यू. सो वी आर नाउ इन दिस आउटसाइड गार्डन एरिया ऑफ नानावती हॉस्पिटल एंड मेनी ऑफ द फेसेस दैट वी सॉ देयर इन द कोविड आईसीयू विद द फेसेस कवर्ड. नाउ यू कैन गेट अ लिटिल बिट ऑफ अ बेटर सेंस ऑफ दीज सिस्टर्स हु वर्क देयर. एंड इट्स इंपॉर्टेंट टू रिमेंबर दैट इन नानावती देयर आर ऑलमोस्ट 50 पीपल, मेडिकल स्टाफ एंड फैमिलीज हु आर इन्फेक्टेड, व्हिच इज क्वाइट अ हाई नंबर. एंड दैट्स द काइंड ऑफ question mark under which they're all working. Just tell us your name, apna naam bataiye.
My name is Purnima Dalvi.
Purnima?
Dalvi.
Dalvi.
Myself Kavita Murgan, resident in Dharavi.
Okay.
Myself J.R.P. Muthu, resident in Dharavi.
So, aap sabne, you all worked in the COVID ward, aap wahan kaam kar rahe hain. Aur aapka testing bhi hua?
Yes.
You were tested. You
tested
all?
Negative.
It all came out negative. But at the same time, There is a pressure about working there, jo aap bata rahe the that in your case, you have to live here.
Yes.
And you were about to get married.
Yeah.
What happened?
My marriage was fixed at April 29th.
Huh.
My fiancé was in abroad.
Achha.
Due to that case, my marriage was postponed and I was called here to work in COVID ward. In initial days, I was tensed because I live in resident in Dharavi. My family is also got tensed because my marriage is near.
Right.
So we get counseled by our Mugdha ma'am and Kavita sister. Kavita sister is our coordinator. She counseled very well. So I convinced my parents that all the blessings of the prayers will be with me. So don't worry.
So now when are you getting married? Whenever.
No idea.
But it will happen, right?
Yeah. Okay.
But both of you live in Dharavi.
Yeah, we both are from Dharavi.
That itself is such a place which has become a hot spot.
Yeah, it's a hot spot only, but there it's like the situation is like people are so casual till now. Till now they are so casual only.
They're not taking it seriously.
Some people are in some areas. It just differ from areas to areas.
Right.
Like that, up to them whether we need to take care ourselves or not. It's like
But are they okay, local neighbors and everyone are fine ki aap log aake yahan, you're working in this hospital
actually,
in a COVID ward, or are they
initially
any...
they were glad only, they too were supporting. But the thing is, after finishing the COVID duty, I went to my house, but not that much happier. They are like, how you handled, then how come you came negative? So many questions they were asking, how come you went to COVID and then how come you became negative? Also
some people are neglecting us while we are moving to the, we are staying in the chawl areas. While moving beside them, they used to get side and give us space to walk.
Oh, they don't want to come
here.
Yeah,
they
want
to come
some
here.
People are treating like that
in Dharavi.
Yeah, actually people are from slum areas.
Okay. Punima, aap bataye, you tell us, aapka, you just had a
baby.
Kitne saal ka?
20 months.
हाँ, but family का support and अभी यहाँ पे सब हमारे मैम मुग्धा मिस कविता सिस्टर ये लोग का सपोर्ट की वजह से मैं यहाँ पे आती हूँ. हस्बैंड को जब भी बोला कि मुझे कोविड ड्यूटी है तो हस्बैंड ने बोला यू आर इन नर्सिंग ना सो यू आर अटेंड कंपल्सरी. अभी तक मुझे अभी लोगों को मैं सेवा करती थी लेकिन अभी देश का सेवा करना है तो वो तुझे करना ही पड़ेगा.
ये हस्बैंड बोल रहे हैं.
हाँ, हस्बैंड ने मुझे
और
फैमिली ने भी बहुत सपोर्ट
किया. बेबी कहाँ, घर पे?
अभी घर पे है बेबी.
और आप यहाँ रह रहे हैं.
हाँ.
तो आप कह रहे थे कि आपके हस्बैंड ने छुट्टी लेके बच्चे स्टेइंग एट होम लुकिंग आफ्टर द बेबी टू हेल्प
यू. मम्मी मम्मी हस्बैंड
अनयूजुअल इंडियन हस्बैंड. बच्चे को देख के कितना दिन हो गया?
अभी तो मैं 5 days हो गए यहाँ पे आई हूँ और मुझे 20 days मोर निकालना है.
बाप रे.
तो बच्चा रहे, 20 month old, मम्मा के लिए कॉल करता होगा, पूछता होगा
कहाँ है. अभी क्या मतलब अभी आई एम इन नर्सिंग प्रोफेशन ना, दैट्स व्हाई नो प्रॉब्लम. फैमिली इज सपोर्टेबल, दैट्स व्हाई नो. मतलब बच्चों को वो देख रहा है अच्छे से.
बच्चे का नाम क्या है?
मानस दड़वी.
अच्छा, उनको क्या बोलते हैं, मम्मी कहाँ है?
ऑफिस में गई है बोलता है.
ऑफिस में गई है, दैट्स लवली. जो लोग पॉजिटिव टेस्ट हुए उनमें से आपका कोई जान पहचान का भी लोग था, कोई फ्रेंड था या कोई जान पहचान?
या पॉजिटिव, एक्चुअली लास्ट टाइम वी वर अंडर कोविड सो वन पॉजिटिव स्टाफ वाज देयर विद अस ओनली. एक्चुअली वी वर नॉट अवेयर बिकॉज़ द रिपोर्ट कम्स लेटर ओनली.
ठीक है.
एंड वी बोथ वर लाइक मिंगलिंग विद देम, वी यूज्ड टू टॉक विद देम, बट वी यूज्ड टू वेयर मास्क एंड ऑल.
वाज दैट अ स्कैरी मोमेंट फॉर यू?
लेटर आफ्टर द रिजल्ट केम we were like slight scary because after that only our swab is was going, so we were scary, but then to it we were like, we both are like so supportive and we like let us see whatever it may happen.
Okay.
We have came to the profession, we need to
chalo. Thank you all so much for talking to us. All the very best. Thank you.